you use to identify. By bacteria. Here are your new terms for today. Crystal violet, which is the primary stain. Iodine, which is the mordant. Acetone or alcohol, which is the decolorizer. And saffronin red, which is the counterstain. Here are some old terms that you're going to have to use to understand this material. Peptidoglycan, gram-positive, and gram-negative. The Gram stain is a time-old microbiology standard. It is the first way that a microbiologist will attempt to identify a strain of bacteria. Even if they cannot identify it, the Gram stain is a great way to narrow down the options. Basically, the microbiologist will take a sample of the patient's specimen or bacteria that they have grown and stain it so they can look at it under the microscope. This method of studying bacteria was developed in 1884 by Hans Christian Gram, a Danish doctor working in Berlin. Gram was studying lung tissue sections from patients who had died of pneumonia. In this picture, normal lung tissue is at the top. Lungs suffering from pneumonia caused by Streptococcus pneumoniae is in the middle, and then at the bottom, lung tissue that has received medical treatment. Back in 1884, Gram was getting frustrated because the staining techniques used back then could not really distinguish between the cells of the lung and the cells of bacteria. So that we can see how amazing Dr. Gram's stain is, first we need to know how anything is stained in the first place. Ever tie-dye a t-shirt? The same principle applies to tie-dyeing that applies to Gram staining. Step 1. Prepare your specimen. Before you tie-dye a shirt, you have to get it ready by washing the shirt and soaking it. Step 2. Apply the dye. You then need to apply the dye to your shirt. It's important to wear gloves so that you don't get it all over yourself. Step 3. Wait. After you apply the dye, you have to let it absorb the dye so that it sticks. Step 4. Wash it. After you've let the dye soak into your t-shirt, you have to wash the shirt. It seems a bit crazy washing your shirt after you've purposely dyed it, but you don't have to worry, because the dye is essentially stuck in the shirt now. Step 5. Dry it. After you've washed your new shirt, hang it out to dry. Now you have a fancy schmancy tie-dye shirt. Or long johns. So, back to staining. Before Dr. Gram came along, staining worked much in the same way. Step 1. Prepare the specimen. Usually the specimen will come in one of two formats. Either you are looking at the specimen the person gave you, urine, phlegm, snot, blood, spinal fluid, joint fluid, etc. Or you will have already grown the bacteria, which we'll talk about later, and you are now looking at some of the bacteria you grew. Either way, you put your specimen on a glass slide like the one shown here. After you put your specimen on the slide, you need to let it dry there. If you do not, you're going to wash it right off in the next step. Most often, the microbiologist will let the slide air dry, or they will put it on a heat block, which is basically just like a rectangular hot plate that warms up the slide so they dry faster. If you want it to dry really fast, you can hold your slide over a Bunsen burner for a few seconds. Not long enough to burn your fingers, but long enough to dry the specimen and fix it on the slide. And by the way, I've burnt my fingers a number of times. The smart way to do this is to hold the slide with a pair of forceps. So this is like if you need to look at it really fast, you can use this, but it's not really recommended. If you can let it air dry, that's pretty much the best way to go. Step 2 is staining it. Once the specimen on your slide is dry and your specimen is fixed, you pour liquid dye all over it, just like you would tie-dye your t-shirt. Step 3, wait. When you stain bacteria, you have to give the stain some time to soak into the bacteria. It depends on the stain you're using, but it can take anywhere from 40 seconds to a few minutes. Step 4, wash it, and step 5, dry it. After you've let your dye sink in for a while, you will wash your slide off and then look at the whole thing dry so that you can see it under the microscope. But as you know, as I already said, the staining technique was a bit frustrating. If you were staining bacteria you grow, no problem. Your bacteria should be the only thing you see on the slide. But if you're looking at a body sample, especially tissue, just using one simple stain made it really tough to tell the difference between bacteria and other things. So, back to Dr. Graham. He started playing around with different dyes to see what would happen if he used more than one on a bacterial specimen. Dr. Graham realized that if he added crystal violet, which is purple, and iodine, which is kind of yellow-brown, if he added them together, water would not wash it away. It became water insoluble. It created this precipitate that kind of got stuck there. Why does this matter? Because Dr. Graham realized that this insoluble dye could be removed from body cells and some bacterial cells by washing them with alcohol or acetone. Acetone is the stuff in nail polish remover. So think about this. We put crystal violet and iodine on a specimen. Okay, it sinks into all the cells. It sinks into your body cells or whatever, and it also sinks into the bacterial cells. However, Dr. Graham realized that if he then flushed it with alcohol or acetone, it came out of the body cells, and it stayed in the bacterial cells, well, at least some of them. Some microbes would actually hold on to the stain despite the alcohol wash. Dr. Graham described how he was able to visualize what we now call Staphylococcus, Streptococcus, Bacillus, and Clostridia in his tissue samples. In this procedure, some bacterial stayed purple from the crystal violet, and some bacterial cells became clear because the crystal violet was washed away by the alcohol or acetone. Because it's kind of hard to see clear cells, the doctor recommended using a counter stain, something to color the cells that had become clear. He used Bismarck brown, but today we use safranin, which is a red dye. Ultimately, this means the bacteria you look at in a slide will be purple, which is gram-positive, or red, which is gram-negative. And you can see in this picture down here at the bottom the exact steps. So our first step is the application of crystal violet. Then we add in iodine. After that, we do an alcohol wash, and you can see in the colors of the bacteria, some stayed purple and some went to like a clearish color. Afterwards, it was counterstained with safranin, or safranin. Either way, it doesn't matter. It's red. We basically have been using this procedure for over 100 years, and it works great. But lest you feel insignificant and stupid for not coming up with this amazing procedure on your own, Dr. Graham actually had no idea how this actually worked. He just knew that it did. It took quite some time before scientists were able to study bacteria enough to figure out how and why it worked. Since the Graham stain is so incredibly crucial, we need to look at it more in depth and figure out why it works. It all comes down to peptidoglycan. Peptidoglycan is one of the components of the cell wall of all types of different bacteria. Some bacterial species have a thick layer of peptidoglycan, like the bacterium on the left, and some bacterial species have a thin layer of peptidoglycan on the inside, and an outside layer of fats and sugars. If you want to get sciencey, that would be phospholipids and lipopolysaccharides. If the bacteria has a really thick peptidoglycan layer, the crystal violet dye sinks in when the cell is stained. If the bacteria has a thin layer, it doesn't absorb the crystal violet very well. Plus, it has to get past all the lipids and sugar, so there's even more trouble. So, in step 3, when the bacteria is flooded with alcohol or acetone, which is notorious for taking out color, the bacteria with the thick peptidoglycan layer kind of holds on to the crystal violet, while the one with the thin layer doesn't stay purple. This is due in part to the mordant, the iodine, Because like I said before, when the crystal violet and the iodine come into contact, they form an insoluble precipitate. So if both of that is being absorbed into that thick peptidoglycan layer, it makes it really hard for the alcohol or acetone to wash it away. Think about it. Imagine that you have two sponges. One is really big and thick, like one you might wash your car with, and one is small and thin, like one you might use to wash your dishes. If you saturate both with water, which one is it easier to get the water completely out of? The big thick sponge or the little thin one? Obviously, it's much easier to get the water out of the thin sponge. And the same thing with cells. It's way easier to get the dye out of bacteria with a thin peptidoglycan layer than it is to get it out of one with a thick layer. Bacteria that stay purple during this procedure are called gram-positive. Bacteria that end up red are called gram-negative. And I cannot express to you how important it is for you to remember this. This will come up in every single lesson in this course. So get it straight now. If it's purple, it's gram-positive. If it's red, it's gram-negative. So again, here are our steps and what happens at each one. Number one, you fix your bacteria on your slide with heat or by letting it air dry. Two, you stain it with crystal violet. Three, you stain it with iodine. Four, after that you add your alcohol or acetone. The purple will stick in gram-positive, that is the bacteria with thick peptidoglycan layer. And the gram-negative bacteria will lose all the stain and it will become clear. Step 5, you have to wash it with water after this. Otherwise, the alcohol or acetone will keep eating away at the crystal violet. You don't want that to happen, so you kind of have to stop the reaction. Now, so that you can see your gram-negative bacteria, you have to counter-stain with safranin, and that turns them red. There are a few terms that we should be clear on. The primary stain, the first stain that goes on, is crystal violet. The next dye that goes on is called the mordant. A mordant is a substance that is used to set dyes. This makes sense because iodine, remember, makes that water-insoluble compound. It really allows the crystal violet to dig in and set in the bacteria. We then add a decolorizer, which is alcohol or acetone. And you can remember this by thinking about nail polish remover. Obviously, it's removing the color of polish. It's decolorizing it. Oh, amazing. So to stop your decolorizer, because you can definitely over-decolorize if you just leave acetone or alcohol on there, it will eventually even eat away all of the purple, even in your thick peptidoglycan layer. So you have to be careful. So to stop this process, you have to flush it with water. And then the last stain is called the secondary stain or the counter stain. We use it to color the gram-negative bacteria, and it's almost always safranin, which is red-colored. So in the end, you might get a specimen that looks like this. Here we have purple gram-positive bacilli and red gram-negative bacilli. Both of them are rod-shaped. Who cares? I care. As we said, this is most often used to test and distinguish between different bacterial strains. So let's say you look in your microscope and see the following. You are seeing neutrophils, which are the larger pink circles with the darker pink nucleus in the center. It's sort of comma-shaped. And you're also seeing gram-negative cocci at the arrows. Now, there's a lot of bacteria out there shaped like spheres, but you're going to be able to narrow down what you're seeing by the fact that it's gram-negative. Okay, we can tell it's not the Staphylococcus species, which is gram-positive cocci. You can see that in the picture below. It looks quite different from our example specimen. And it's not Streptococcus species, which is also gram-positive cocci, although this one is in chains, whereas Staphylococcus is in clusters. So again, this looks much different from our specimen. So you already know that it's not a staph or a strep infection. This particular bacteria is actually Neisseria meningitidis, which can cause quite a few different diseases depending on where the bacteria has infiltrated the body. So you see, the Gram stain helps us really narrow down the possibilities. A medical microbiologist would not know just by looking at the slide that it was Neisseria meningitidis, but they would let the doctor know that they saw Gram-negative cocci. The doctor, based on this information and the clinical symptoms the patient is showing, would try to diagnose the patient and start treating them while the microbiologist did other testing to confirm the identity of the bacteria. Here's the official Gram stain procedure. 1. Prepare and fix slide. 2. Stain with crystal violet for 1 to 2 minutes. 3. Flood stain with iodine for 1 to 2 minutes. Decolorize with acetone for 2 to 3 seconds. 5. Rinse with water to remove acetone for about 20 seconds. 6. Flood slide with saffron and counter stain for 2 minutes. 7. Wash with water. 8. Dry. 9. View. Basically, the Gram stain is the first test a microbiologist does to figure out what bacteria they're looking at. Through this course, you'll start to learn which bacterial species are Gram-positive and which are Gram-negative. Now, the Gram stain works great for most organisms, but it doesn't do so well on our Spirilla, which are really too thin to be seen under normal light microscopy. This means the bacteria like treponema, which causes syphilis, are tough to see. Other microbes just stain better with other types of stains, which we'll talk about when we get to those specific bacterial strains. For example, Mycobacterium tuberculae, which causes tuberculosis, works best with what's called an acid-fast stain. So if you just try using a regular Gram stain on it, you're not going to get really good, clean results. It's not really going to look positive or negative. It's just going to be messy. So an acid-fast stain is better for this one. The biggest problem with the Gram stain is that it's really easy to decolorize too much or too little. It takes a lot of practice to decolorize just the right amount of time. Part of this particular slide has been over-decolorized. The purple in the middle is the true color, but around the edges, this Gram-positive bacteria looks Gram-negative, and it's all because the acetone sat on it for too long. So you have to be really careful when you see bacteria that are the same shape, but some look positive and some look negative. Your Gram stain just might have been off, so you might have to redo it and make a new Gram stain and make sure not to over-decolorize. But in general, the Gram stain is pretty awesome, and it's the first question you should ask when identifying bacteria. Is it Gram-positive or Gram-negative? So think about this. Later in the course, you will be identifying bacteria. What's the first thing you should ask? Is it Gram-positive or Gram-negative? It's really going to narrow down the options.